the Oregon State Beavers have struggled in the NCAA tournament in recent years. But this year, they defied the odds and made it to the Elite Eight of the tournament. Let's talk to Oregon State's fellow American guard, Jared Lucas, about their history-making journey. All right, so Jared Lucas, right here on ANC, of course, a Phil American who played for Oregon State Beavers. Jared, thank you so much for joining us here. Congratulations on Oregon State making it to the Elite Eight. I just want to ask you, of course, what was it like? You know, what was that run like for a team that has been struggling, you know, for the recent years, and you weren't really expected to make it to that far, making it that far in the March Madness? Tell us about that experience with your team.
It was a great experience. Like you had said, nobody really expected us to get there. Early in the year, we had struggled. Eventually, we kind of everything fell into place. And, you know, I told a couple other people the last time, it was since 1990 since our school has made it this far and even won a game in the NCAA tournament since 1990. And we won our first Pac-12 championship, our tournament championship in school history. So it was crazy. It was crazy how everything happened. We were projected last place in our conference, and we ended up winning the conference. So it was crazy, but, you know, I guess, like I said, everything fell into place and we came out on top.
What was it like playing during a pandemic? I know that there have been so many obstacles, tournament stopped, and then eventually, you know, you defied expectations. What was it like from your experience? You know, no fans, and then so many restrictions. Can you tell us through the process?
You know, every morning we got tested. Every morning we got tested, and then... it was just a little different this year because we had two separate locker rooms as well. There was on every arena you went, they separated. So like six or seven guys in one locker room, six or seven in the other. So like pregame talks before the game, discussing the game plan and stuff like that, it was hard. And you kind of had to do it on the bus, stuff like that. It wasn't easy. But it was cool. And the one time it hit me was when we were on the road playing a team. It was a two-point game with 15 seconds left, like a third game of the season. And the play was drawn to me, and eventually we didn't get to it, but there was no crowd noise. You know, usually you can feel the anticipation. You could feel the crowd, you know, screaming. You could feel everything, and you didn't feel anything. It was weird. You kind of had to get yourself going.
All right. So overall, what was it like playing in the March Madness? You know, even though there are limited, you know, access, but Filipinos were still talking about it on social media. And of course, you know, basketball, anything basketball really kept up the Filipinos. What was it like now this year? You know, and considering you're only on your sophomore year, Jared, and having this type of achievement.
It was crazy. Like I said, it was crazy that we had gotten here, but for how far we made it to the Elite Eight, it was a great feeling. But like I had mentioned, you know, there were so many teams that could have participated in this, and we were one of the 68 to get into the field. Playing in a pandemic wasn't easy for anybody, but I'm glad that my teammates and I all kind of made it safe from COVID. Yeah, it wasn't easy, but it was good, and I definitely felt the love from the Filipino community as well.
I understand, Jared, that also, you know, getting to know you more, you have a deep sports background, you know, with your dad being a coach, your brother being also an athlete. So can you take us through that family roots, you know, with the influence of sports in your family?
Yeah, my grandpa was a Filipino Hawaiian. He played football at the Naval Academy. He was a great player himself, so he kind of all started it in my family. My mom played volleyball in high school, but the rest of us, my younger brother's a really good volleyball player who'll be making his college decision the next couple of months or so. My dad played basketball at the University of Hawaii, so it's kind of how I grew up. And then my dad's also been a high school coach for 25 years, so I'm somebody that's grown up in the gym and dreamed of playing at the college level and eventually, hopefully, in the pros.
Did your dad also, you know, have a big influence on you? You know, of course, when you have dads that are coaches and when you have coaches that are dads, it's kind of a different dynamic, right? And what was it like in high school when you were in your growing up years, when he would really, you know, he's your coach, right? So what was it like, you know, at home and on the court and how you guys developed as a, you know, as a relationship?
It wasn't easy for both of us, I could say early on. It was almost like we had like family issues, or family, not family physical fights, but, you know, family fights, because I'm somebody that's super competitive. I hate to lose. So when we lose, you know, I'd get on my dad, hey, we need to do this, 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 and this. And he'd get on me at about the same thing. You got to do this, this. So it helped me stay accountable, but also it was great at the same time. I realized that it is a once in a lifetime opportunity. Not everybody's fortunate enough to, one, have a dad that played Division I basketball in the United States, but also to have that kind of dad-son relationship as coach and team and player.
We want to get to know also, Jared, from your perspective there in the United States, recruitment process are a little bit more different, right? Of course, when we get to, you know, conceptualize or maybe contextualize it here in the Philippines, what was the recruitment process like for you? You're based in California, but you went to Oregon State. Can you take us through that role and that process on what was it like for the coach of Oregon State and for the school to recruit you?
Yeah, well, Oregon State had first started talking to me. They'd given me a call in eighth grade. They had called me and mentioned that, you know, they had heard my name, but they were just going to stay in contact, which was really early. They were one of the first schools to ever talk to me. Eventually, their head coach called me again my sophomore year of high school. I didn't hear from him for a while. Talked to me again my sophomore year, mentioned the support they have for me. Eventually, I went up to campus, got an offer my sophomore year of high school to Oregon State. And then at the end of my junior year, I committed there. But Coach Tinkle, who's our head coach, coached his own son, Trace Tinkle. And I played for my dad. So I felt like that father-son was something I can relate to as a coach and as a player. But also at Oregon State, they play in the Pac-12, you know, with teams with the likes of UCLA and USC. And I figured I want to play at home. I eventually want to go beat UCLA and USC, which fortunately enough, my team did. This year, we beat UCLA in the Pac-12 tournament, beat USC at home. And those are some of my goals. If I were to go to Oregon State, I wanted to beat teams like UCLA and USC.
All right. So also for the benefit of our viewers, if you got to watch the March Madness this year, one of the notable players besides Jalen Suggs, you know, besides the guys from Baylor, also Johnny Juzang, right, from UCLA, made it to the Final Four. He was actually your teammate, Jared, when you were in high school. So can you tell us more about that?
Yes, me and Johnny played together in seventh grade. I consider him one of my best friends. I've known him since we were like 13 or 14. We played together, played against each other also. But I'm so happy for him and what he done. He took his team to the Final Four. Me and him were actually talking because we had beaten them in the first round of the Pac-12 tournament. When we had beaten them, they were unsure if they were going to make the NCAA tournament. So I told Johnny, I said, hey, man, if you guys make it, go out there and kill it, dude. And he did. He had an amazing tournament.
Now, Jared, I want to get to know also the PhilAm community. Of course, groups like PhilAm Nation Select, you know, paving the way for PhilAm players to be more known in the Philippines. So can you tell us more a bit about that influence and what's it like working with them, having their influence basically?
Yes. Yeah. It's great to have somebody in the United States to help kind of relate us or help get our name out to the Philippines. Obviously any PhilAm has roots in the Philippines and not everybody knows it. Like for me, I still think today, not everyone in the Philippines knows that I'm Filipino. So having PhilAm Nation really helps us kind of get back to our roots, help people connect, help us to reconnect with people. So I couldn't be more thankful for it. I'm happy. I'm a proud Filipino.
All right. So speaking of roots, so where are your roots from?
Yes, Samar. My family is from Samar.
I know also, Jared, that you were supposed to go a couple of years back, but that was pushed back because, of course, you know, you were in high school and, you know, maybe are there plans in the future to visit and come to the Philippines and see what it's like?
Oh, yeah. Eventually, that's something I want to do. It's on my bucket list. I want to do it as soon as possible. Obviously, with COVID, it's not easy to travel anywhere. But like you had mentioned, Migs, I almost traveled to the Philippines with Jalen Green, Kihei Clark, all went out there. I was really close to doing it. I was in high school. I would have missed like 2 or 3 weeks of school, and I couldn't have done it with my academics I had going on at the time. I wish I would have done it.
All right. So there you have it, Jared Lucas right here in ANC. But lastly, Jared, you're just currently on your sophomore year. You're currently in an uptrend right now. So you also had your career high against Stanford, 26 points, and it's only uphill from here. What's next? What are you doing now? How do you plan to pan out your college years? What are your plans?
For me, on the basketball court this summer, I'm planning on working on a lot of different skill things on the basketball court, such as my shooting skill, my ability to score off the bounce. and really just becoming a well-rounded player. And then off the court, I want to do my best to be a young man in the community, a child of God, and then really just get to my dreams and making it to the NBA, whatever it takes.
Follow-up question, how many years do you plan on staying? Is there like a pipeline?
This next year, if I can make it to the NBA, that's the goal. I'm really working this year to make it to the NBA this upcoming year. And if not, I still have another 2 more years left. So whatever it takes, but I know for myself and for the rest of the Filipino community, just know that I'm working and I'm going to eventually get to the NBA.
What about playing for the Philippines? Playing the Philippines, is that like an open mind? Do you have an open mind? You know, maybe, you know, want to play for Gilas Pilipinas, given the opportunity?
Yes, I definitely have an open mind to that, and I wouldn't mind doing it. Like I mentioned, I'm a proud Filipino.
All right, so there you have it. Jared Lucas right here on ANC from the Oregon State Beavers. Congratulations on making it to the Elite Eight. And Jared, thank you so much. Stay safe and God bless.